Our project brings together some 2,000 of the museum's most important medieval and Renaissance artifacts within a suite of 11 galleries on 3 levels. The project is part of the museum's future plan, within which a running series of projects is revitalizing the entire museum. The project was funded through a range of grants and private donations. We are the architects of the project and were commissioned in 2003 as the result of an international design competition. The competition was for exhibition design. However, in our submission, we also proposed a fairly significant alteration to the building itself. We understand from the V&A that it was a combination of our approach to the artifacts, the method of their display, to light, daylight, together with our approach to the historic fabric of the museum that resulted in us winning the competition. It is this that I'll explain today. Before doing that, I'd like to emphasize that this is the result born out of collaboration. As architects, we led a team of very supportive and talented consultants. And as the exhibition designers, we worked very closely with the V&A themselves, with a team of curators, each experts in their own field, educators, conservators, object handlers, and mount makers. It was a close collaboration over 7 years. This was hugely exciting and enjoyable for us. And as architects and exhibition designers, we found we were able to allow the artifacts to influence the architecture of the V&A and the V&A's own architecture to influence the exhibition design. And somehow we found a way to try to stitch those two together. The V&A is a museum of art, of craft, and design. And throughout its life, throughout its history, it's used the building itself, the fabric of the building, to showcase the best in contemporary art and design. Our project seeks to continue that tradition. The brief, the V&A have 20,000 medieval Renaissance objects. We were re-displaying 2,000. And pulling together objects that were very different, there's sensitive textiles, medieval timber, and there's pieces of stone. And with textiles, we have to think about light. The timber, we have to think about humidity. And the stone doesn't really mind, but it's a thin relief that really wants light to show the carving. And then we have objects of a massive scale to display. And together with those objects, so tiny, I don't think you can really see it. So it's there. We've got tiny objects, but fabulous. An ancient brooch, a little fish. And that little fish has a curatorial role to play in a narrative that links within a sub-subject all of these pieces. Those pieces then connect into a subject with other pieces of different types, different conditions of display required. That little fish up in the top right corner is sitting then within a gallery with a number of subjects all having their own relationship. And that gallery sits within the collection, sitting within the 11 galleries. So how do we bring all these things together? That was the challenge that we had as architects. We have to think about the adjacencies of these. The curatorial narrative was well developed. We have to think about the context, the shape of the building, the structural support, how do we hold them up, how do we display them, and their sensitivity. Our site is in the southeast quarter of the museum here. And it's an interesting group of galleries with long, small, and then this vast hall in the center. So it's a gallery of great interest. But before we worked there, there was no control of the light in the central hall. The perimeter galleries had been locked up in order to prevent daylight coming in, to produce more wall hanging surfaces. Other rooms had been subdivided and were being used as offices. And the reason this was happening is the architecture of the building didn't work so well, and this end of the building was completely isolated. With our design, we changed the building and we recovered the original spatial sequence. We reintroduced daylight, and remembering the types of objects we have, this is actually almost fighting the needs of the objects. But we are thinking of this as an experiential, from an experiential point of view. What's it like for a visitor to be there? And viewing galleries in daylight is much better, we believe. We made new connections to visually tie and physically connect the galleries. Then, having opened up the galleries, rather than building walls to create zones for the curatorial narrative, we used the objects themselves to structure the display. And key objects strategically placed to help the visitor navigate through the galleries. So, back to the gallery before. This is the same view after we were finished. And the textiles that I talked about at the beginning are to the right-hand side, just out of view of this. Or in the main gallery, Gallery 50, we introduced controlled daylight control, just as a simple way of filtering light, enough that when we created the gallery, this is the gallery entitled The Renaissance City, Objects from a Cityscape Outside in a City, and we could now cast shadow on the objects. It's no longer flooded with light, but it's still very light, very well lit. And then moving through the same gallery, where we start to encounter light-sensitive objects, this gallery is entitled Sacred Spaces, where all of the pieces are from ecclesiastical interiors. We managed to negotiate a change to the building fabric, and it is grade one listed. So a change like this took some years to agree. It is reversible. We've not harmed the building in any way. It can come away, and we've got the Victorian glass roof still there. But this allowed us to drop the light, but you can still see we get little shafts of sunlight filtering through. And what we're doing with the building's form is trying to evoke, without pastiche, a church interior. It's the objects themselves that are saying this is a church interior, but we're just using the existing form of the building, reshaping it a bit to adjust quantity of light. And then the chancel end of the room, it's the objects themselves that give the clue of the Santa Chiara Chapel at the very end, terminating this. Now we found through these openings some space that wasn't in our sight, and we claimed them because we had copes, we had religious textiles to display. And by moving them through into these little spaces, which were painted black, we were able to then to make the main gallery a lot lighter, because most of these artifacts are 250 lux. Through the perimeter galleries, this is a display in the Gallery of Devotion and Display, a room where every artifact is about thinking about God. And we were looking to create a serene environment for the display of these objects, but not so much about a church. Some of these would come from people's own house interiors. This was just a serene environment to set up the objects themselves to be beautiful pieces. But instead of blocking windows, in this gallery we also had a huge number of wall hung objects and not enough wall surfaces. So instead of blocking windows with plywood like previously done, we found a way with translucent stone to create structural hanging screens in the gallery and filter daylight into the room but give more hanging surface. But for us, really, the main thing is a beautiful background for the display of objects. Or in the adjacent gallery, stained glass is displayed against the window. The light comes in the window, the light comes through the glass, the light comes behind the glass. It's a way for us to use the window surfaces for display, but in a way that we don't block light. And then changing the color of the room to room, to avoid museum fatigue. One room after another is slightly different, but common materials running through. And then showcases that we designed to remove all framing, just to almost dissolve the architecture so that we can focus on the piece. The Pisano's little ivory Christ there. And it's positioning having our relationship with the mother and child. Or these little people with their own character, they get a different type of plinth and they're set up to welcome the visitor into this gallery where the Devonshire hunting tapestry is forming the background. Now, through these objects, and in thinking about using them to structure space, we encountered pieces like these doorways, and in the museum the doorways are displayed against a wall to hold them up. These are very thin slate reliefs, which we just couldn't face doing, and we proposed a way of cantilevering 5.5 meter high steel plates from the floor. And these doorways, these are funerary doorways, they introduce a section called Tombs and Monuments. It's using the door, the artifact, to structure the space. Or altarpieces, freestanding, like they could have been in original cathedrals. Or balcony fronts, this flat display previously on the wall, we ask a question about the historic fabric of the building and whether there is one place we could find one new balcony. There were original balconies, and with a new balcony, we found a way to connect the Renaissance Palace interior in this gallery with the Renaissance courtyard and garden below. With the object itself brought back to life, the object becomes a balcony front again. The capitals, cloister capitals, that we had to display in a gallery that had a section entitled Great Churches, the capitals then are displayed at an appropriate height, reminiscent of a cloister, but there's no pastiche. We're not faking anything, it's just a clue as to what the object was. Structuring the space, and then looking through that gallery, a medieval window. Medieval window, previously again displayed against a wall. Could we make it stand on its own? There's 7.5 tons of stone. How do we make that stand on its own? So we said, can we put in a 25-ton solid stone base and cantilever from that some metal hoops? Problem was, the object was in storage. We didn't really know the size of the object. And it took, I think, nearly 2 years through the V&A laying out the pieces to let us know the size. And then we gambled on committing to the shape of the hoops. These hoops being something we felt would be harmonious with the object, but clearly distinct. And then with a bit of flexibility in the way we're connecting, there's no new holes made in the artifact. These are all into soft mortar joints. We then end up with a structure where the artifact's clearly defined. It is a window, but it does create zones that sets up a reliquary here. Well, it was a reliquary when we started the project. By the end, it was a tabernacle. There was a revision to its understanding. A ceiling, the Cremona ceiling. You see that it's been taken from a palace in Cremona. You see the fragmentary nature of it, that it structures the space below. Where we look to careful groupings of pieces and careful lighting to show the beauty of the pieces themselves. Or groups of portraits talking to one another, visitor hiding, walking amongst them. The new light levels allowing us to cast shadows in Giambologna. The gallery of devotion display and the grouping of objects taking advantage of the onyx. It's about trying to set up the most beautiful way to show the pieces in this museum of art and craft. But back to why the building didn't work. It started off as the South Kensington Museum, and then the South Kensington Museum grew across the site, and a visitor to London will come upon it and think it's a considered complete entity from this facade in Cromwell Road, like the British Museum. But it's not really. It's a group of separate buildings that have gradually been connected together to create a bigger museum. Our site, in this corner, in a way suffered from that. There was a change of level from the main museum to the perimeter. And the only lift access to our gallery would have been going through the main door, turning to the left, going up to the fifth floor, going across a bridge to the right, and finding one of these lifts coming back down. Otherwise, you use the stairs. So in our competition entry for this exhibition design competition, we suggested there was an argument to remove some staircases at the end of this axis. And it is a Grade 1 listed building, but how can we remove these stairs, add a lift, and bring new disabled access to this corner of the museum? So the stairs, as they were actually a barrier preventing anyone going down the way to this gallery. That's where the onyx screens are on the crucifix. We said, let's remove this and add in new circulation that got us access to 6 floors of the museum. This is the space below, before. That was the main delivery ramp into the museum. These are the bridges, the public spaces that we needed to remove. But this is then what we can achieve. We You take away a piece of a building, a listed building, and you end up with quite a scar. So we worked together with historic building specialist Julian Harrop Architects, who found a way to stitch the building back together to bring what was, I'll just go back to show you, that was inside the building, and this is the light well outside. So how do we connect the two together? They conceived of this way to complete the architecture, in front of which we inserted a modern insertion where we managed to create a thin floor slab that spans between where we can insert two floors within each single gallery. That floor slab is just concrete. The floor surface is concrete, the soffit's concrete, no finishes, no thickness. This is the new space. And I mentioned before, we're trying to think about the history of the museum as a museum of craft and design. And this is a highly crafted piece of concrete, a piece of design that's all about the craftsmanship to make. This is in-situ poured concrete meeting glass and steel. And then the crafted restoration next to the modern, always clearly distinct, a bit like the way we'd work with objects, working with the building. The modern is clearly distinct from the historic. New vantage points looking over this newfound space. And then at the very top, we found a new view of the Brompton Oratory that was not publicly available before. And that's been achieved through creating this new space, the first new space in the museum in 100 years. And it's an amazingly weird geometry that existed there. There's parallel lines and then non-parallel lines. And we thought of a way of just connecting this together with translucent glass beams. And those glass beams through this geometry with this constant top datum and bottom datum actually create a rippling, undulating roof, which we wished to use to frame the views to the artifacts. So no one's really looking up and seeing plants and buildings around. It's all about the focus on the objects. But it's actually, the space itself is quite a dynamic space, and this roof helps to take advantage of that. And it gives us a space to incorporate some very large objects. This object itself, I have to admit, the first time we saw it, I kind of wondered what was so good about it, really, because it wasn't very beautiful, we thought. And we're kind of wondering why, after working with Jean Bologna or other pieces. But when you look at it, you realize a lot of what we were saying was modern had been added to support the object over the years, in the 70s and the 30s, whenever. And the object itself had these incredible treads, these propeller-shaped, twisted, medieval forms that are amazingly crafted. So we asked a question, we just asked, you know, why do we need all that? Can we just take it away? And what are we left with? And if we take away the modern, we were left with something quite sculptural. And we conceived of a way to add back a distinctly modern piece of support, but to find something that we thought could be a sculptural event within the museum. And this is where we had an advantage, being the architects of the building. We were at the same time building this wall, so we could find a way to support the building on the new wall structure, which we were building into this void space in the museum. So we have main contract working along, and at the same time we're working with the object. The main contract was moving quite quickly, and we actually established that we didn't really know the size of the object. We had a digital survey, but then it had been taken apart and all the modern pieces removed, and no one really knew what size it would be when it came back together. But we had to find a way to establish levels and make connections through to the building structure. I'm using this as an example of one object. We did this with quite a few. This is the sort of work we enjoy with conservators. But anyway, the blue shows what we put into the main contractor's work, and the red is us asking questions of the curators. How high is it going to be? Where is it going to end up? And how do we give you the steel structure to support it? Meanwhile, we managed to finish the structure for the main contract. With some flexibility, we decided vertically. But then, looking at the new posts, and understanding that it's actually not very straight either, it's a very lovely medieval thing, the steel work we're getting made, we have to draw for people to fabricate, so we drew it. And these points, we understood, were going to change. So we set it up, and we went to the storerooms where it was being conserved, and through careful measurement of the pieces on plastic, we found a way to establish on the right-hand side just how much these would move, so we could gamble to fabricate. But at the same time, the conservators were getting concerned that the object was actually very fragile, having taken it apart. How would it go back together? And asked us to find ways that it wouldn't bear any weight in itself any longer, which is quite difficult. So the new post came down and landed on a tread. We're asked to find a way to make it not land on the tread. So we made, and we didn't quite know the shape of it, so we worked with cardboard models and the object to check everything would fit. And then we issued the cardboard model to a steel fabricator to construct. We've usually issued drawings, we've never issued cardboard before. But then it got made, and the stair starts to get built. And as we move up, we find that the new posts in the centre there, they do arrive where we expected them to arrive. And this form's gradually becoming apparent. And the way it got built, we had this one single piece, carved piece like a totem pole, was fabulous. And then around it, these pieces came along. And the steel was designed to be cut to length on site, so we could adjust the height as we built up. An object got built up. But it was designed so it didn't put any weight down. So theoretically, we can do that with the staircase now. None of the weight has been transferred down there. And that's what it looks like afterwards. And we're quite excited that people now stop and draw the staircase when they're in the museum. They used to walk past it where it was displayed before, but now they stop and draw that as well as the sculpture. And you see the treads now becoming apparent in this incredible medieval carpentry showing. So we had a medieval facade that survived the Great Fire of London. We did the same with that. And it sits at the end of the gallery and it creates wonder amongst visitors. Ambrose and Gregory hung on the wall and a method of support to allow the pallet to be moved around in a forklift truck, never, but mainly for us, just looking very beautiful and serene against the brick wall. And this is the space that's completed. It's about the connecting of the building together. It's about making the building work for the objects. It's about how we can be distinct about the modern intervention within the architecture, but also create the right environment for the objects themselves to be where they want to be and to look like they should be there. And that was the project, but I just thought I'd take advantage of you since we're all together and ask you a question, anyway. Architects get given briefs, and we are concerned about the environment, and we are always given briefs that talk to us about international museum standards and lending criteria. And we've got a question, maybe, why do we need to spend so much energy making temperature and humidity not vary at all in museums? We understand international criteria allow a little bit of flexibility, but I'd like to ask how far you guys, as museum directors, are willing to let that go. V&A is leading, in a way, in this, in that their conditions alone are broader than the international museum standards. In our gallery, our brief originally was to have fully air-conditioned galleries with tight temperature and humidity control. But as an increasing awareness became part of our practice within the museum, and really with the support of Sir Mark Jones, our project has removed air conditioning. It's removed any humidity control that's mechanical and any mechanical temperature control. And what happens now is, in winter, a visitor to our museum or our galleries will find it very cold. And the reason we'll find it very cold is that we're controlling humidity by letting the temperature fluctuate up and down. And in the summer, visitors will find it warm. But they should be wearing t-shirts and shorts and coming into the museum from an outside space that's warm. It's always going to be cooler than outside or warmer than outside, a bit like a monastery is. And Mark Jones was quite good at supporting this vision, or this, it's not our vision, the collective, but this argument, in that he would be saying these medieval pieces have been around for so long and temperatures fluctuating. The museum's conservators agreed that the main thing for us to do was to slow down the rate of change of temperature and slow down the rate of change of humidity, and that way we can protect the artifacts. I'd quite like to ask, can these criteria be further relaxed? How far can it go? I know some places will need air conditioning. It gets warm here, warmer than London, but maybe not to such a tight band, especially for landing. Thank you very much. Thank you.